Yeah, we are live.
All right. Thanks, Amit. Welcome back, everyone, and welcome to the morning talk session. We have four very interesting talks lined up in the morning session, and I'm Preeti Bangal, and I will be moderating this session. First up, we have Kaushik and Ramya, who will be speaking about capacity building for bird monitoring in Nagaland that they have been working on. Kaushik is a project assistant at the Nature Conservation Foundation, and he has been working with the Bird Count India team, conducting workshops in the Northeast India to kick off bird monitoring. He's helping the local people there become active birders and helping them use eBird. He's also particularly interested in learning all possible ways to which citizen science can contribute to our understanding of ecology. And Ramya is from the Wildlife Protection Society of India and works on biocultural research in Nagaland in the Northeast. So can we have their talk, please?
Hello, everyone. I'm Kaushik Sarkar from Bird Count India.
And I'm Ramya Nair from the Wildlife Protection Society of India.
And today we will discuss our experience of capacity building for bird monitoring in Thanamir, Nagaland. A large proportion of Indian population lives closer to the natural landscape. People living there have a wealth of knowledge on natural history, be it plants, mammals, or birds. And most of this knowledge is embedded in the culture in the form of stories and rituals. But many a times this information doesn't reach the mainstream science. There are certain barriers to it. First of them is a language barrier, where the science is in more technical English language, while the cultural knowledge exists in the local language or dialects and is passed on via stories. Another aspect is that people do not have access to high-end technology. And further, there are very far and few opportunities for training which can enable people to contribute to science and governance. Given this context, a brilliant opportunity came from one of the remote places of Nagaland, Thanamir. And the opportunity was to conduct a training program on bird monitoring.
So Thanamir village lies at the base of Mount Saramathi, the highest peak in Nagaland on the Indo-Myanmar border. This region falls under the Indo-Burma biodiversity hotspot and has been recognized as an IBA, or Important Bird Area, by BirdLife International. Thanamir's community forest roughly spans 65 square kilometers and consists of multiple habitat types, ranging from subtropical evergreen to even alpine scrub. This region is the traditional homeland of the indigenous Yimkim Naga. Within this backdrop, Thanamir village is a wonderful setup. It is known as the Apple Village of Nagaland, and residents held an annual apple festival in pre-COVID times. Residents also pursue nature-based subsistence activities such as slash and burn farming, fishing, livestock rearing, mushroom picking, and hunting to meet their food and cash needs. A majority of forests in Nagaland are owned, used, and managed by local communities. In Thanamir, to curb overhunting of wildlife in their forest, the local village council and student union have instituted multi-part hunting bans across their community forest. For 2 years now, our team have been conducting systematic surveys to document mammal diversity using camera traps. However, after spending some time there, we learned that hunting bans had been instituted keeping birds in mind. Hence, to focus on birds, we reached out to Bird Count India to collaborate on a workshop and training. I have a little experience with birding in the past, and my team have incredible knowledge on local species, their behavior, and migration patterns. To prepare for the training, we decided to club these skills together and begin going on trails around the village and get comfortable using field guides for bird identification, knowledge of local species, and develop the habit of making checklists as a way to systematically collect this data. In an ethnography, which is my research approach in Thanamir, learning the local language is an important tool to break the barrier of being an outsider. While team members have incredible knowledge on birds, their groups, and migration patterns, writing down checklists and making records in English was quite a foreign activity. So to get things moving, we set up a two-way learning system. We made a deal, Kaushik and I made a deal to have a system where we would learn the local names of species and the team would learn English names of species. And that way we were all engaging and learning collectively in unfamiliar grounds.
While we were still learning to write in Chir and English language, as of us new to this landscape and the birds, we started exploring all the habitat that Thanamir had to offer. It started from the scrubby slopes of the old Jhum, the dense oak forests, the higher elevation forests, the ridge tops, the rivers like Vurito, and even the snow-covered areas near the peak of Mount Saramati. And while we were exploring, we were also trying to practice making good checklists, including bird counts. After any birding session, we would come back together, sit, and discuss what all birds we saw, how did we identify it. And the next time we saw the bird in the field, we would make sure everybody had a good look at the bird and could identify it later. And such birding sessions were conducted regularly. Apart from the outdoor sessions, we also had detailed indoor sessions, which included detailed discussion of bird identification, bird families, which were like woodpeckers, barbets, and warblers. We also discussed what were the best practices for birding, what to look out for, what behavior we should do. And lastly, we would also discuss about how to do systematic data collection using transects and how to lay them when in later time we need to do a study. While all this was happening, we introduced the team to the eBird app. Me and Ramya were already using it, but it was new to the team. It was a very convenient and easy tool to make a detailed checklist, which recorded all the data we needed, the time, date, distance, location, and of course, all the birds and their counts. And this helped team members to join eBird and also made Thanamir a popular location in the birding community.
We kept improving our skills after learning of the ways that this data can contribute to citizen science as new eBirders. Our checklists kept getting more detailed and we made them both on paper and on eBird. Many team members now began recording their trails and transects on eBird and continue to do so till today. Soon enough, many of us began climbing up the list on the top 100 eBirders in the region, and this was very encouraging. Birding for the joy of it. As we came closer to the end of the training, there was no doubt that the enthusiasm levels had risen. Our list kept getting longer, and we were all on the lookout for the 200 species. Most importantly, we were all critically identifying species we came across, and there were many times that we went back and forth with some species and even changed previous IDs to new ones after more thought and research. The highlight of all of this was when the team went out and recorded their first independent checklist.
And this checklist was not an easy one. It was done on Mount Saramati, and the team encountered a bird, a rare bird, Rufous Vented Laughing Thrush, which also had a very similar looking counterpart, but they identified correctly and came back with a robust list covering 2 kilometers distance and spent over 3 hours debating and getting into the proper ID of the birds, and team never looked back from it. And which eventually gave very brilliant results for the program. There was a very robust list for Thanamir now, 220 and still counting. The team members have become very good birders and are self-sufficient to monitor birds and can even do a study at a later stage if required.
Our goal with the training was also to provide the team members with options of additional livelihoods by equipping them to be bird guides, whether it was for birding teams who came as tourists or even scientists and researchers.
So all this needed a very sustained interest among the team, and it stayed so. The team has been submitting regular checklists from the place. It's been 4 months since the program has been completed. They have recorded very brilliant sightings, including Rufous Necked Hornbill, Chestnut Munya, Hodson's Frogmouth, and Jordan's Plaza. And the list has not just been expanding for Thanamir, it has been expanding for the whole district of Kifire. When I arrived in Thanamir, the Kifire had 250 species, but when I left, it had 292, which was a huge expansion. So with the current interest in what has sustained, what you finally learned from this workshop? There were simple steps that made the whole workshop successful. First, the use of local language, which broke many barriers, made communication easy. Second was positive reinforcement. The appreciation encouraged the team, and later on, we also appreciated them through a certificate. Another thing which was very important was the long-term engagement, where we spent good enough time with the team, like we became friends, and it takes time to learn. It takes time to make those bonds and make things easy to understand. And that can only be achieved by long-term engagement.
The last addition to that list would be sharing how this data could really make an impact in team members' lives, whether it was about equipping them with new, possibly monetizable skills, or even giving back to the community and contributing to evidence-based suggestions, which would strengthen local governance in their own jurisdiction. Through this training and presentation, we want to highlight that using some of these principles and customizing them to each landscape's needs can pave the way for more capacity building workshops across the country that could contribute to citizen science, especially in parts of Northeast India and in community-owned forests like Thanamir.
We would like to thank the people of Thanamir, Nagaland, Mr. Toshi Wungtung, and the Dibang team who visited us in Thanamir. Thanks to all the funders, Bird Count India.
Thanks, Kaushik and Ramya, for that wonderful, inspiring talk. You have plenty of questions coming in on Slack, and I'll try and take some of them here. Prabhakar is asking, first of all, everyone says this is a wonderful way to break barriers. And Farida also says that she loves this idea of mutual learning. The first question is, did they create all individual accounts on eBird and contribute? And how did you handle connectivity issues?
Oh, the connectivity issues were actually very bad. At one point of time, we did not have electricity for 1 month. So most of these checklists are mostly on notebooks. And as and when the network comes back, so people submit the checklist. Most of them stay unsubmitted in their phone as of now. And sorry, what was the first part of the question?
Did they all create individual accounts on eBird?
Yes.
Okay. Right. The next question is from Nishant. Great work, especially learning local names. Best wishes for your work. Do you put them for publishing, especially with local and English names?
We don't know yet, but we do maintain a register which contains all the bird names in both English and Chit dialect. Many of the birds actually did not have a name in Chit. So we asked the elders and with their consultations gave them one. For example, warblers are called Thangke. And there's this warbler called chestnut crowned warbler. So we named it Kosom Thangke. Kosom means red. So we do have a list of it, but yeah, that would be a good idea to go ahead with.
Prabhakar is also asking a follow-up question. Would you now consider documenting other species and biodiversity of the area?
I guess that Ramya can answer.
Right. So this project is, and this collaboration especially came as part of a larger ongoing project where we had been documenting mammals for the past year. And because these are all rooted in strengthening local governance, we decided to move on to birds, and we hope to document more taxa as we go forward. While also, I think, following up from this training, set up monitoring systems for birds especially.
Right. Thanks, Kaushik and Ramya. I'm sure you'll continue to get questions on Slack, and please do continue to engage with our audience there. Thanks for the lovely talk. We'll now move on to our next talk for the day, which is by Shyam Patiyan. He will be speaking to us about assessment and of scope and relevance of citizen science in Indian higher education institutions. Shyam is an associate professor at the Nalanda University School of Ecology and Environmental Studies, and he runs his own citizen science projects through the INAD platform. Apart from this, he is also offering an elective course on citizen science at the university, and his main goal is to mainstream citizen science in higher education systems in India. So over to you, Shyam.
Namaskar, I, Shyam Patyal, along with Harsh Yadav, wants to discuss scope and relevance of citizen science in Indian higher education system. Look at the title of the article. It highlights the problematic sides of the traditional teaching. We teach students what is already known and ignore the crucial element of teaching, that is the process of knowing. To deal with problem, we need to integrate citizen science into classroom teaching and ensure the productive learning experience. Instead of memorizing the known facts, students must be engaged in scientific knowledge productions and encouraged to know the process of knowing. You know, citizen science ideas ensure the continuous learning process beyond the hours and boundaries of a classroom teaching. Educational institutes are known for their broader social context. Citizen science activities help them to create a better social capital and improve the scientific temperament of larger society. Citizen science already marked its presence in India, but it seems heavily leaning towards few selected research disciplines in selected institutions at selected geolocalities. To prove our point, we assess the perceptions of all stakeholders of higher education system and ask them to judge the scope and relevance of citizen science in Indian higher education system. To achieve our goal, we carried out pan-India survey, invited more than 3,000 participants irrespective of their educational and professional background. 10% of them responded, covering most Indian states and union territories. We found the North India and Southern regions were the most engaging one. A closer look of this graph indicates most of respondents were from the urban and metro cities, highlighting a clear societal divide. Majority of our respondents were youngsters below 30 years of age. A large section of the respondents had at least UG degree that saw high potential of citizen science among university going students. When we ask about respondents' field of study in highest degree, more than 50% indicated biodiversity, ecology, environment, and life sciences. In the context of familiarity with citizen science, many participants highlighted that they were hearing it at first time, but a good number of them come across this word during the UG and PG level. Although ecological and environmental sciences were the principles and preferred discipline of citizen science, still the respondents were also signify other fields, though not so popular. When asked about their interest in citizen science, more than 80% willing to board on this. 74% of our respondents lacked hand-on practice experience in citizen science. The number are similar when it comes to the status of attending courses on citizen science. The student community is always a significant segment of the volunteer populations, which is also an attribute of citizen science. However, a poor understanding of citizen science may hamper their potential even if they board on this platform. When we asked participants about their familiarity with most common citizen science platform mentioned over here, only 30 to 40% were familiar with a few platforms such as Indian Biodiversity Portal, iNaturalist. Almost equal amount of participants were totally unaware of about them. Despite doing a good job, Season Watch was preferred, known for only for 11% of participants, which is a matter of concern. Seek is a good app for school students. I will discuss Foldit and iWear later on. Interestingly, about 70% respondents were aware of one of other citizen science platform, but only 20% of them contributed the data. Despite the low data contributions, almost 70% of them trust citizen science data, which surprised us. To prove their trust, we can dig a little deeper. The iNaturalist data in GBIF is clear evidence of high trustworthiness. The PLOS One paper highlights the reliability of citizen science data. A recent paper in Rapid Mapping of Fire Effect on Biodiversity used iNaturalist data using citizen science approach. For the success of citizen science, it is also essential to understand the barriers hindering it. Most participants highlighted all the above given options as potential barriers, but most prominent one is the lack of knowledge on citizen science. Participants feel citizen science can be a relevant subject. More than 80% supported having a citizen science subject in a university curriculum. When we asked them, do you accept citizen science as a powerful tool for better learning opportunities? Most of them agreed to this. Additionally, we asked whether our campuses should have a citizen science club like other cultural clubs. More than 80% agreed to this. A good example is US universities' campuses where having a citizen science club is a common scenario. More than 75% favored to get rewarded for citizen science activities in the form of extra academic credit points. We specifically asked, should the Indian higher education system need to introduce a full course on citizen science? Two-thirds of respondents like this idea. When we ask whether they are aware of global recognitions of citizen scientists for their contribution, 95% had no idea how rewarding it can be. Let's have a look at this article in Nature and just the value of citizen science. One more, where iWear, a citizen science gaming platform, recognized as a co-author of the article in this gamer from 150 countries are mapping neurons and solving scientific mystery. Another one about the Foldit, where the gaming group were given the authorship for their exceptional contributions to unfold the protein within a short span of time, where the professional scientists struggle for decades. To conclude our study, we have following take-home message. First, lack of formal knowledge about citizen science, limiting its potential to achieve desired goal. There are a clear subject and geography-wise division concerning citizen science activities in India. Citizen science is a mainstream education can support building a cross-talking network of institutions to achieve similar research objectives. Additionally, National Education Policy 2020 focuses on practical learning. Inclusion of citizen science as a model curriculum also able to fulfill this vision. At Nalanda, I have developed a citizen science course and assign regular tasks to students related to citizen science, like this one, where we documenting the biodiversity of Nalanda, where students have contributed 750 observations within a year, despite of the pandemic restrictions. Similarly, this is an early spring flower phenology project that encouraged students and the general public to indulge in citizen science activities. With this, thank you very much for your attention. We are now open for question and answer. Thank you.
Right. Thank you so much, Shyam. That was a wonderful, insightful talk. And we have some comments and questions on Slack for you. I'll read out a few. Sai, who works with Season Watch, is saying, thanks for the insight on the reach of Season Watch. We have some outreach work to do now. And Nishant is asking a question. I would like to know how what is the attitude of teachers and officials in schools, especially for students in higher secondary schools, towards nature awareness initiatives? Is citizen science helping make their approach favorable? Would you like to share your thoughts on this? Hello? Shyam, are you with us?
Yeah. When I introduced this course, in fact, when I got, hello. Tithika, can you hear me?
I can hear you. You're breaking up a little bit, but we can hear you.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. When I introduced this course in Nalanda, students were very happy about that. And students were very happy about that.
Hello, Shyam, you're still breaking up a little bit. Maybe
indulge
turning off the video.
So it was appreciated by the university.
Sorry, Shyam, we still can't hear you clearly.
Appreciated by the
Maybe Harsh can help us take the questions, but Shyam, can you hear us? Okay, Harsh, would you like to answer that question?
Yeah, so can you repeat the question?
Yeah, sure. So Nishant asked, what is the attitude of teachers and officials in schools, especially for students in higher secondary schools, towards nature awareness initiatives?
So basically, when Professor Shyam introduced this course in Nalanda University, so earlier students were unaware of what is citizen science, as our study also supported this point that lack of awareness is and lack of knowledge is one point. So also when basically citizen science is that the practical learning is the practical learning process. So the idea was when the citizen science course was introduced to get students on board for more of the learning which is on field instead of the theoretical process. But yes, the basic idea is to enable students to learn and to get the skills which is required for the citizen science project, because as we found that students or the general public also which involved in the citizen science projects are basically just as a volunteer. They work as a volunteer. But to get them the better skills which are required for citizen science, so a proper course and the curriculum is important. So idea initially, as Professor Shyam, so he was able to make students and others understand that how important citizen science in not just biodiversity or ecology and other disciplines also. But as the process continues and as the course flourishes, then students were more interested towards citizen science. And yes, now many of the students are taking up citizen science in their thesis and in their project work.
Right. Thanks, Harsh, and thank you, Shyam. You have some more questions on Slack. Please continue to answer them on Slack. Unfortunately, right now, we have to move on to the next talk. Thank you both so much for being here.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Our next talk is by Swaroop Patankar, and she is going to be talking to us about the use of eBird data for conservation in India. A little bit about Swaroop. Swaroop is a senior project assistant at the Nature Conservation Foundation, and she is an environmental science and technology graduate from Pune with a keen interest in studying urban biodiversity and ecology in its cities. As an aspiring ecologist, she wishes to explore the data source that is eBird and think of ways to inculcate this in her own studies. So can we have Swaroop's talk now?
Hello, everyone. Today, I will be presenting case studies of use of eBird data for on-ground conservation prioritization, advocacy, and action in India. To give a brief background, eBird is a citizen science platform developed by Cornell Lab of Ornithology to document bird diversity and abundance. It was introduced to Indian bird watchers in 2014, and India soon became the fourth largest contributor to eBird. With a nationwide network of volunteer reviewers, eBird is currently the largest open-source data repository for birds in India. To give a perspective of the growth, more than 27 million observations have till now been recorded from India to eBird. The total number of Indian eBirders is more than 26,000 and total completed checklist more than a million. The coverage map of eBird checklist shows that checklists have been uploaded from all over the country. Over the years, eBird data has been used in a variety of ways. It has been used to predict the impact of climate change on high elevation bird species, for long-term monitoring and population assessments of certain species, as a tool for nature education, and of course for informing conservation priorities, which I will be discussing today. We divided these case studies into three categories, and I will be discussing each in detail. eBird data has been crucial in criticizing the ecological impact assessment reports prepared for the developmental projects in fragile habitats, as many times these reports show false information in order to gain clearances. The first example is a peer review of the environmental of the conservation plan prepared for the Italian hydropower project in Dibang Valley. This plan, which was prepared after a short 5-month survey, showed lacked critical information like the actual species richness and presence of migratory species in this site. The eBird data, which was cited for this review, showed presence of 563 bird species, 30 out of which were of high conservation concern, according to the State of India's Birds Report, which I will be discussing later. Many of these species were range restricted and highly susceptible to disturbance. Thanks to this review, this project was scrapped. A similar review was prepared for the projects proposed through the Bhagwan Mahavir Wildlife Sanctuary in Goa. Particularly, the EIA report for the Castle Rock Kulam railway line, which was proposed to pass through this sanctuary, showed presence of only 35 bird species after a short 2-day survey. But the eBird data showed presence of 236 bird species at this site, making this an important bird area. eBird data has been successfully used as a legal evidence in campaigns against industrial expansion and fragile habitats. Wetlands have always been on the receiving end of industrial growth, as they are thought of as degraded lands. In both the campaigns against Adani Port expansion at near Pulikat wetland and Sun Pharma expansion near Vedanthangal wetland, eBird data was successfully used by the campaigners to show high species richness and bring about legal intervention. Same cannot be said for the Dasai wetland in Haryana, which fell prey to a construction and demolition processing plant Even though campaigners showed used eBird data to show presence of high species richness and also presence of more than 30,000 birds annually during the migratory season, that their estuary had started showing signs of improvement after rejuvenation efforts in 2019. However, the revival of the Loop Road extension project by the High Court put this habitat into threat. Again, campaigners used eBird data to show not only presence of high species diversity, but also presence of two Schedule 1 species, that is the Black Baza and the White-bellied Sea Eagle at this site, which were helpful in putting a stay on this project. eBird data has similarly been helpful in petitions against road expansion projects at the Girivalam path around Arunachala Hill in Thiruvananamalai and the felling of trees for an airport expansion project in Dehradun, which would have impacted the Thane forest and the critical Shivalik elephant corridor. Since eBird data has been used to assess the population status of birds in India, it forms a baseline for the reassessment of the conservation status of India's birds. In 2020, 10 organizations came together to prepare the State of India's Birds Report, which is a comprehensive assessment of the population status and distribution of 867 bird species in India. This report has identified 101 species of high conservation concern and also states that 52% of the populations of Indian birds are in a state of decline. However, contrary to popular belief, some species like the house sparrow has shown stable abundances across the decades in India. eBird data has been used for the red list reassessment of birds like the Indian skimmer from its state as vulnerable to endangered, and the reassessment of the Malabar grey hornbill from its state as least concerned to vulnerable owing to its decline in decline in abundance over the decades. Many conservationists have used eBird data to get legal protection to certain birding hotspots all over the country. The Important Bird Areas book is a comprehensive compilation of the IBAs in the different states in the country. In order to gain recognition as an IBA, the site has to conform to certain international standards of bird species richness and abundance. And eBird data has been used in several of the IBAs in different states to get this recognition. Similarly, to get proposals for the IBAs and zones of importance for migratory shorebirds in Goa have used eBird data to make their cases. In Mumbai, the local birding groups, which regularly participate in bird races arranged by eBird, are now motivated to get the birding hotspots and these novel urban habitats legal protection, like the Bhandup pumping station, which shows high species richness owing to its presence of a mosaic of habitats at this site. The Manivelsundan tank in Salem is the second most important birding hotspot. However, it was in a state of decline and degradation. The Axon Foundation, with the help of Salem Ornithological Foundation, have restored this tank to its former self, and eBird data was helpful in realizing its importance as a birding hotspot. Similarly, the local birding groups in Nanjangad used eBird data and checklist at the Narasambudi Lake to show presence of high bird diversity, which was threatened by the presence of fishing nets which were left in the lake. And thanks to this report and a letter to the Tahsildar, this lake was cleaned up. A very interesting story is that of the Kiddur village in Kerala, where what started as an eBird checklist in 2015 soon snowballed into a bird fest in 2017 and a road being renamed after the rare orange-breasted green pigeon, which was recorded here. And now the Biodiversity Management Committee regularly monitors the bird diversity in this village using eBird. And the Salem Ornithological Foundation is using eBird to make their case to get the Stanley Reservoir declared as a Ramsar site. Apart from these direct uses, eBird data has been successfully used in disproving the role of migratory ducks in spreading the avian influenza in Kerala. And eBird data is also used as a reference in the City Corporation environmental status reports. From these examples, it is clear that eBird data has started becoming a convenient data source for on-ground conservation initiatives. One of the key features of eBird is that it is free, open source, and easily downloadable from the platform. And in many of the hotspots, historical data is also available. And anyone can use the myriad of tools available on the platform for free to analyze their data, to observe patterns, which ultimately aid in on-ground conservation action. With this, I would like to thank the following people who very kindly passed on their experiences to me. And thank you to these for their continued support.
Thanks, Swaroop. That was a lovely talk. You have a few questions in Slack. Pankaj is asking, can you tell us a little about how you access information of how different people are using the eBird data? He means whether this is different from literature or is it by talking directly to researchers, activists, etc. Do you also have an idea of how much or what kind of information is used by activists in legal intervention or other kinds of intervention? We can't hear you, Swaroop. No, we still can't hear you. You're unmuted, but I think there may be a problem with your microphone. Still no luck.
Can you try checking your settings, your microphone settings? Yeah, can you change your audio source in Zoom? It's in the bottom left. Audio settings at the bottom left.
How about now?
Yes, great. We can hear you. Great.
Yeah, okay. So we sent out emails to people who we thought would have examples of use of eBird data for conservation initiatives. These were mostly people who have campaigned against developmental projects or against EIAs. And we also looked for publications on Google Scholar and articles, popular articles, news articles on Google. And all these sources were used to compile this information. And what was the second part of the question?
He's asking whether you have an idea of how much or what kind of information is used by people.
Okay, so for now, from what information we have gathered for conservation uses or for the campaigners are just using the checklist as a legal evidence in courts. Because while making their petitions or while making the reports for those areas, they are eBird data is a convenient source to have a checklist of all the bird species that are that are found in that area. Even in some cases, historical data is also available from eBird, which makes the case stronger. Primarily just the checklist and the species richness data from the hotspot or the relevant area is used currently.
Right. Thanks, Swaroop. I think you have a couple of more questions on Slack. You can continue to answer them on Slack. For now, we will have to move to the next talk. Thank you so much. All right. Our next speaker and the final talk for this session is by Nishant Venugopal. His talk is titled Prose and Poetry to Citizen Science, Being a Nature Enthusiast. Nishant is a nature enthusiast who quit his 15-year-old job as a producer in a leading news English news channel to pursue his passion for nature and wildlife conservation. He's an avid wildlife photographer. He writes poetry and prose and uses his website and social media channels to encourage people to observe and preserve nature and share optimism towards conservation. Over to you, Nishant.
Good morning and welcome to everyone. I am Nishant Venugopal, a nature enthusiast, and this is a presentation on prose and poetry to citizen science. I would like to share a term called biophilia, an innate and genetically determined affinity of human beings with the natural world. As Eduardo Wilson, American biologist and writer, said, "You teach me, I forget. You show me, I remember. You involve me, I understand. Involvement is necessary to bring back that connect with nature. Citizen science initiative can be a great way to involve with nature. Now, here is an ancient way of storytelling. Our ancestors, who were explorers, used to record events and objects and also tell their stories to others using these cave paintings. Today's storytelling tool is social media. A powerful medium to communicate, but with power comes responsibility too. Now, you know that there are more than 390 million mobile internet users in India. Younger and older generation both use social media effectively. You can use this for the benefit of citizen science. Many would like to involve with nature conservation efforts. Theodore Roosevelt, 26th President of USA, said, "Do what you can with what you have where you are." To inspire people to involve in citizen science initiative through storytelling and social media is my outreach plan. You can see that social networks have a reach, major reach among people. And using hashtags, you can create cross-references, especially to encourage citizen science initiative. Awareness is the key for conservation. And as it is said here by Baba Diou, the Senegalese conservationist, in the end, we will conserve only what we love. We love only what we understand, and we will understand only what we are taught. So, I will share two important terms in social media marketing. Social media monitoring that focuses especially on a campaign or institution or a brand, and social media listening that helps to find interesting trends. Social media listening also helps you to collaborate, to source information, and look out for special days related to conservation efforts or citizen science initiative, and also can be a tool for user-generated content. Art and science can be combined. Stories from those who are involved in citizen science initiative can inspire others to involve in such initiatives. Remember, app moderation from organizations are also needed because we don't have control on what a person writes. Proactive involvement is necessary. And for this, stories from people are important. People love personal stories regarding species. Counting days are important too. And even after counting days, if we keep on this involvement, it will help to generate interest among people. Merging stories and facts about species and personal experience will increase the passion among the people towards nature. Keeping this in mind, in my second part of this presentation, I am sharing a few stories, articles, and poems I wrote. Here is one, which is regarding a story of a caterpillar growing in a host plant. Here it is the common vermin caterpillar in a curry leaf plant, which is quite common in India. And this article, Nature's Lesson During Lockdown, which I wrote for Conservation Optimism, was mainly to promote awareness among host plants. There are other issues that these species face. So during Big Butterfly Month last year, I also wrote a poem, Behold the Butterfly, taking all the issues that came into my mind and also journaling the life cycle of the butterfly, which was received quite well. Now, in the case of dragonflies, we know they are called the tigers of the insect world. They are carnivores and they need clean water source for their survival. So a poem was written on Odonata species and images were shared with apt hashtags so that the coverage is maximum. It was published in Science Next Door. Now, thanks to CITESAI India 2020, I came to know about this citizen science initiatives on wild canines, known as wildcanine.net. I wrote about jackals that I have observed, in and around Delhi. It is important for the urban ecology, and also people should know about urban wildlife, how they adapt and how also they become victim to anthropogenic pressures. Now, there is a surprise element too, which we can share. Like in this case, last year I recorded this oak blue species near my home, and many butterfly enthusiasts said that it is the first record in Delhi. So you never know in your backyard, near your house, what kind of species you might come and you might observe. And it might be an interesting anecdote too. There are few more poems that I wrote and articles that I wrote, which are shared in various platforms too. Great interest among people, which includes frogs, snakes, lizards, tiger, and even owl, to also to share some of the myth about them and what is the reality and how they adapt to the urban landscape. These were shared in special days so that people will always remember them. Now, another one that I would like to share, another point is that about safaris, people go to look for the charismatic species and they forget other species. There are no species to look for in such places. This was what I wrote, In Search of Tiger, as a guest post for Cape Town Conservation, where if you can locate other species too, and if you are part of citizen science initiative or other such initiatives that will record these species, it will be a good data for many researchers. We must have more eyes and ears around such places. Now, when it came to the pandemic crisis, everybody could have had to face it in various ways, and it was a difficult period too. I am sharing this small quote from Rachel Carson, the author of Silent Spring. Those who dwell among the beauty and mysteries of the earth are never alone and are wary of life. So during the lockdown, I was not able to travel. And it was a good time for seeing the migration of species. So while sitting at home, I was able to see movement of a migrant species, Rosie Sterling, near my residence. It was only possible because I was staying at home. And to inform about this, that wherever you are, there is a chance for you to be in connect with nature, I wrote this small blog, Visitors with Wings. Now, the pandemic crisis is hit hard on many people, and there is benefit of being a nature enthusiast. I would like to share this small poem that is Life and Learning with Nature. This is a hobby that you can have at any time of the year. Age is not an issue, whether you are older or younger. All that's needed are your attentive eyes and ears and open mind to accept whatever nature offers, from the balcony gardens to protected habitats that you can reach. Look out for the mysteries and lessons that nature can teach. Another poem that I wrote regarding citizen science is to emphasize that a traveler or a photographer, all Also, a curious mind can take part in citizen science initiative. It will not only expand your own knowledge, but maybe, who knows, it will be a new lease of life for that species or its habitat. I wish the success to SIGSci India 2021, and thank you for the organizers of SIGSci India 2021 for allowing me to share this presentation, and thank you for those who heard this presentation. If you have any thing to share about this presentation, I have written my contact details in this play and you can contact me. I hope this will inspire others to observe the nature around them, to preserve the records, and that will help in conservation of the species or habitat. And thank you very much once again, and best wishes to all of you. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Nishan. Wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing all your poetry and prose with us. You have some comments coming in on Slack.
Thank you.
Jagan says, with power comes responsibility. Isn't this a quote from Spider-Man?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, what I would say is that there are a lot of hidden gems when you think about literature, which you can use for the purpose of nature. And that's what I try to do, mix both of them so that general public is getting interested.
Right, yeah, thanks, Nishan. Farida also says that this is indeed a unique way to use citizen science projects. And you show us a way that it need not only be science, but can be art and literature as well.
Yes. I would say, in case of science, if it has to reach the heart of the people, we have to take the help of art. So both are actually complementary, or you can say both can help each other.
Right, I agree. You have requests for sharing your blog and poetry. Please do share some of your articles and poems with us.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think this was a very interesting approach. Thank you for sharing and being here live with us today. You can continue to engage with our audience on Slack as well. You will have questions and comments coming in the appropriate thread in today's channel.
Thank you, SIGSci India, for giving me this opportunity. And I will be in contact with people who are asking for various information through Slack. Thank you very much. Thank you, Preeti.
Thanks, Nishan. We've come to the end of today's morning talk session. We have another session in about 30 minutes at 12:30. So please be back at 12:30. We have a short break right now. And also please continue to post your questions on Slack and engage with our speakers there and with each other as well. Thank you, and thank you for joining us.